Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the academic track of the State of the Map 2021 conference. We have already watched three very interesting talks about research applied to OpenStreetMap or research with OpenStreetMap. We had a first talk about natural language and OpenStreetMap, the second about machine learning and OpenStreetMap, and the third one about localness of OpenStreetMap data. Now we move to the fourth talk, and it's my pleasure to introduce our next speaker, that is Dipto Sarkar. Dipto is a GI scientist whose research is situated at the crossroads of GI science, human geography, and digital geography. And is not actually new to the OpenStreetMap academic track and to the OpenStreetMap community. Some of you, or many of you, would probably know him because his research interest, the main one at least, is to model interactions, especially in a spatial context. And he's currently an assistant professor at Carleton University in Ottawa, Canada, and he completed his PhD from the McGill University in Canada. In this work, there's also a co-author, that is Jennings Anderson, and many of you would for sure already know Jennings for his contribution to the OSM research and to the OSM community. The title of the talk is Community Interactions in OpenStreetMap Editing. So we will have the video now, and feel free to ask your questions in the meantime, and we will ask those questions to Dipto afterwards. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to our presentation entitled Community Interactions in OSM Editing. This is part of my and Jennings's research on quantifying and qualifying corporate editing activity in OpenStreetMap. Throughout this conference, we have seen that various groups of users are attracted to OSM to contribute data and to use the data which is available on OSM. Thus, the users and producers of data in OSM are really a community of communities, each of whom bring their own unique interests and experience in making this eclectic group which co-produce the data in the platform. Some of the notable groups of contributors in OSM include enthusiasts who are really excited about OSM as a project and thus contribute and use the data. Hobbyists are people who mostly are attracted to a particular hobby and want to improve the OSM data and use the OSM data pertaining to that hobby. For example, if you are really into skating, you probably want to digitize every skate park that is there across the world so that every person on earth who is interested about skating can use the data. Humanitarians want to improve the quality of data in OSM so that the data can be used in humanitarian crisis such as natural disasters. Over the last few years, we have also seen that many corporations such as Apple, Uber, Facebook, and Microsoft are very interested in contributing to OSM as a data and probably in also using the data from OSM. The increasing quality of OSM data and the fact that it attracts so many different groups of users and producers of data signals that OSM is emerging as a mature data infrastructure that can be used in a variety of projects. In this presentation, we are mostly focused on corporate editors. I'll show you a couple of figures now, which shows you the intensity of corporate editing in OSM in the recent few years. Both these figures come from Jennings Anderson's OSM diary post, the link to which I have already included below these figures. The first figure shows you the number of active corporate editors belonging to each team across the different years. The colors denote the different corporations. And the numbers on the y-axis are the number of corporate editors associated with each team. We see that in 2021, currently we have almost 3,000 active corporate editors. The three most active corporations with the largest editing teams are Apple, Amazon, and Crab. Apple and Amazon each have corporate editing teams, which have more than 500 active members. We can see that the size and the number of corporate editing teams have gone up over the years. In 2016, there were only a handful of corporate editors active, but in 2021, as we have already seen, the number is close to 3,000. This figure also comes from Jennings's diary post. This shows the change in percentage of paid editing activity between the years. Colors in this diagram shows the percentage of editing done by corporations versus non-corporate editing teams. Blues denote that a place is mostly edited by non-corporate editors, whereas the red colors denote that a place is mostly edited by corporate editing teams. The intensity of blues and reds shows the percentage of the edits done by either non-corporates or corporates. This figure highlights that the focus of corporate editing teams shift across time and place. Thus, depending on where you are on the earth, you will see different amount of corporate editing at different points in time. For example, we see that in 2016 and 17, Thailand is heavily edited by corporate editing teams. Whereas come to 2018 and 2019, Thailand has almost entirely shifted to being mostly non-corporate edited activity. These micro patterns are visible across the map. These are also visible very much in many countries in Africa. Thus, the amount of corporate editing you see at any particular place is a function of time. Concomitant with the rise of corporate editing activity in OpenStreetMap is the rise of concern over what the impact of corporate editing has on the map. These concerns have also been raised in the OSM community survey. Thus, it is imperative that we as a community are able to quantify the impacts of the corporate editors on OSM, not only as a data, but also as a platform. However, evaluating an impact is a multidimensional question. For example, we can evaluate how data quality is impacted. We can also measure who contributes data to OSM and how. We have already seen the where aspect quantified in the previous slides. We can also see how the size of the community changes in places where corporate editors are active. Another way of evaluating impact is to look at what type of interactions are there between members of the different groups. In this case, this is the question we are most interested in. We want to quantify how do corporate and non-corporate editors interact in the OSM community. However, if we break this question down, this is also multidimensional. We can do this in a very qualitative way and look at what are the interactions between these two various groups in, say, things like the OSM State of the Map conference. We can look at what are the interactions over emails and in the various community forums. But we can also take a very quantitative approach and look at the number of interactions in co-editing patterns. So in this case, we will look at how the data is co-produced in OSM as an interaction between corporate and non-corporate editors. This is the focus of this presentation, and I will go into the details of how we approach this in the next few slides. To quantify co-editing patterns, we take a data-driven approach to characterize the interaction between the corporate editors and the rest of the OSM community. We define interactions through editing patterns, constructing a network of interactions where each node represents an editor and two nodes are connected by an edge if the two mappers have edited the same map object. If the mapper represented by node A edits an object last edited by mapper represented by node B, then the edge connecting these nodes is directed from A to B as A edits an object previously edited by B. Thus, in this network, the node's degree is the number of co-editors of the node, and we can further characterize in degree and out degree since our network is directed. In degree in this network represents the mappers who edited an object after the user, and the out degree represents the number of mappers editing objects before the user. Such a network can have multiple disconnected components, as not everyone in the network co-edits objects with everyone else in the network. To characterize these networks, we only use the largest connected component. That is, we only take the portion of the network where most nodes and edges are connected to each other, and we leave aside the small disconnected sets of nodes and edges. We utilize the OSM interaction tile sets at Zoom level 14 to construct these networks. OSM interaction tiles, interaction vector tiles, contain the editing history of all highway and building objects in OSM. These tiles contain minor changes to the geometry of the object in which only nodes are moved, but the parent way is left untouched. Thus, every small edit to the network can be captured by these tile sets. In this way, we are able to capture the complete history of map objects in OSM, as opposed to just changes in basic OSM elements in which the primary nodes or ways are changed. In keeping with objects which are primarily edited by corporate editors, which have been characterized by me and Jennings in our previous work back in 2019, our analysis focuses only on highways and building objects, as they are the ones mostly edited by corporate editors. The nodes in the network are further annotated with the binary category representing whether that particular mapper is a corporate editor or not. We classify a mapper as being a corporate editor or not by comparing their usernames to the disclosed lists of username on a corporation's OSM wiki or GitHub page. We focus on four locations primarily. Namely, we focus on Egypt, Jamaica, Thailand, and Singapore. We chose these locations because these locations have known corporate editing teams active. For example, Thailand has a very active OSM presence from mostly Facebook and now Grab. Singapore is mostly edited by Grab editors, whereas Egypt has active editors from both Digital Egypt and Apple. And Jamaica mostly has corporate editors from Apple. We create networks for each of these locations at three different time points to see how the interactions have evolved over time. Like I showed you in the previous slide, the corporate editing activity changes in a particular place depending on the time scale. So by creating the network at different points, we are able to capture these changes too. Thus, we constructed and analyzed 12 networks in this analysis in areas where we have different corporate editors active. We are not the only ones to characterize co-editing patterns in OpenStreetMap using social network analysis methods. Previous work has shown that there is limited collaboration between editors, with most objects being edited only a few times. Senior editors perform a majority of the mapping activity on their own, but they do interact with other editors through co-editing patterns, which can be captured by such networks. However, since these studies were performed, some time has elapsed and we have seen new dynamics emerge in OSM, mostly as a result of the high level of corporate editing activity which we are seeing. Thus, this begs the question, how have these metrics or interactions evolved over time, if at all? So let's see some of the results of our network analysis. Now, let's look at how the degree of nodes changed on an average across the networks across the years. Remember that the degree of a node in this case denotes the number of co-editors they have. In degree denotes the number of people who have edited your work, and the out degree denotes the number of people's work you have edited. In this network, we have plotted both in and out degree with solid and dashed line respectively. The colors denote the different places, and corporates and non-corporates are denoted separately using circles and triangles respectively. The most important thing to note about this graph is that none of the groups stand out that much when you compare them to the same place. Thus, you will see that all purple lines are relatively close together, meaning that no group, whether it be corporates or non-corporates, or in degree or out degree, stand out that much or that they are outliers. So within each network, the in degree and out degree of both corporates and non-corporates tend to be comparable. We see that there is some variation between the places, but again, all of the mean degrees lies between around 5 and 30, so there is no real outlier here again, which is again good, which means that there is a bound within which all nodes are operating regardless of the place which we are looking at. We may break this down further and look at the edges itself. When we look at the edges, we can characterize the direction of edits between the various groups. In orange, we see the number of edges going from corporate editing editor to another corporate editor, meaning that a corporate editor is editing the work of another corporate editor. In green, we see the work which is done as a result of corporate editors editing the work done by other non-corporate editors. Similarly, teal shows us editing done by non-corporate editors to work previously done by a corporate editor, whereas purple shows non-corporate editor to non-corporate editor interactions. Here we see that over time, across all networks, the number of edges has gone up, meaning that co-editing as a whole has gone up across the world, across the places. However, the growth between these various edge types is not equal. As corporate editing has become more and more common, edits between corporate editors to another corporate editors has grown at a much faster rate. We also see that there is a growth in the amount of editing done by corporate editors to the work done by other non-corporate editors. There is also a rise in the work done by non-corporate editors in editing the work of previously done by corporate editors, which is shown in teal, but this growth is not as prominent as the growth in the other two. Pardon me, the growth is prominent but not as fast. Again, this shows that when we are looking at corporate editing patterns, the location where you're looking at really matters. So Thailand and Singapore are really comparable, whereas Jamaica is clearly an outlier where the number of interactions between any groups is not that high compared to the other three. Egypt, on the other hand, has seen a significant interest in corporate editing in the year 2019, and correspondingly, there is a growth in the co-editing patterns as well. Associated with each edge, we have also a timestamp. This timestamp allows us to quantify how long an edit persisted before someone else came in and edited the same work. Here we have used the same concept of edge directionality to see whose work persists the longest. Here we see that across all networks, the work done by corporate editor is edited very soon by another corporate editor. This is highlighted by the fact that all orange bars have a much lower median compared to the other bars. This shows that corporate editors are very proactive in editing the work done by other corporate editors. In the other groups, again, they are very comparable to each other and none of them stand out as much. The only standout feature of this figure is that work done by corporate editors tend to be edited very frequently by other corporate editors. In this final figure, we see how an editor's age in the platform correlates with the co-editing which they do on the platform. We plot the editor's age on the x-axis and the number of edits they do to other people's work, that is the out degree, on the y-axis. Previous work had highlighted that senior editors tend to do most of the co-editing work. However, in this figure, we see that this pattern does not hold true for the four locations in question here, except for maybe to some extent Thailand. In all other networks, we see that for non-corporate editors, there are quite a few young editors who have high out degrees, meaning that they are editing work done by other people. Corporate editors, on the other hand, have a trend which is completely opposite to what has been seen previously. Young corporate editors between the age of 0 and 3 have very high out degrees, meaning that they edit work done by others a lot. This is a trend, again, which is completely opposite to what has been previously noted in this platform. So finally, what are the conclusions of the results we have just shown you? What we really see is that OSM is a byproduct of co-editing or co-production. An object in OSM does not exist in isolation. And once an editor comes in and creates an object, it is then edited multiple times by other people. Thus, the final OSM product, which we see, is a product of the repeated edits which the OSM community does to improve the final quality and representation of the object. We have also seen that corporate editors and non-corporate editors interact often in the platform through co-editing. However, corporate editors tend to edit each other's work more often. We have also seen that in case of corporate editors, younger editors do most of the co-editing, as we have seen in the last figure, where most of the editing or co-editing was done by young corporate editors, and the amount of edits they do kind of tails off as their age in the platform increases. So this particular phenomenon, coupled with the fact that edits done by corporate editors last a very small time, primarily because of other corporate editors coming in and editing that piece of work, seems to point to the existence of internal pipelines to ensure data quality. Thus, once a corporate editor does something on the map, it is highly likely that other corporate editors soon revisit the same object and makes minor corrections or ensure the accuracy of the representation, which is a proof of internal editing guidelines to ensure quality of the work. This is all we have to share for now, but we are happy to answer the questions you may have about this research in the time that remains. Thank you so much.
This is a very interesting talk about corporate editors. I've seen some questions appearing in the chat, so we can kick off the Q&A session. But in the meantime, I invite, as usually, everyone to ask additional questions in the chat. So please do, and I start with the first ones. The first one is the following. It's basically related to the previous talk of the academic track. That was about the localness in OpenStreetMap data. Would it be possible to link the previous work from Maxwell, which could conceivably estimate the probability that a matter is local or not, remote, with your research to evaluate the relative quality of paid remote editing in a given local? So it puts together basically the local dimension of a mapper to the, let's say, the paid dimension of a mapper.
So I really liked the previous talk, and I think Maxwell's research is really pertinent for us. And I have struggled with this idea of how to characterize a local mapper before, and Maxwell's ideas really break new ground there. As he has already pointed out, it's very hard to characterize whether a mapper is local or not, because the location of the editor is never captured in OSM tilesets. So I would like to reach out to him and see whether we can work something out. But again, like, he has broken some very interesting ground in OSM work there. And definitely, whatever his outcome is, it will be helpful for not only me, but the entire OSM community and the academic community to characterize the locality of edits.
Thanks a lot, Dipto. And yeah, indeed, we should clearly create synergies whenever possible between research about OpenStreetMap. And we have two very good candidates here. So it would be great, clearly, if you can be in touch with Maxwell and his team to see what can be found out from this. Second question, do you think there is a way to validate your findings? For example, do you consult with a corporation regarding their edit to validate, or do you have a way to verify the list of names you have defined as corporate editors?
So this work is a collaboration between me and Jennings Anderson, as you know, and we have been maintaining lists of publicly declared corporate editing teams. And as the OSM community guidelines clearly mentions that every organized editing team member should be declared on a publicly available platform, we rely on those public lists to get the names of corporate editors. We have not reached out officially to any of the corporate editing teams, but that is definitely something we can do. But for this very quantitative work, I don't think there will be much difference, because again, they are very transparent about what they are editing and who is editing where. So we can just compare the usernames which we find on the OSM interaction tilesets and compare them against the known corporate editors and get a very high confidence about which editing was done by corporates versus which was not done by non-corporates. But yes, it is worth reaching out to them for more qualitative work.
Thanks a lot, Dipto. I go with the next question, which is about the scale of the analysis. Is it possible that corporate editor work can be evaluated not just on the country level, but on regions or even on disaster ninja hexagons inside the country? So could the more detailed locality present more patterns, insights?
Absolutely. Absolutely. This study can be done at various scales. We can do it at a global scale. But the reason we decided not to do it at a global scale is because, like I said in the presentation, there are different dynamics which get played out in different countries. So we did it at a country scale. But obviously, if we break it down to even even finer rail scales, we will capture more detail. But for this analysis, since this work is relatively new, we decided to focus on a country scale because we thought that is the best trade-off for now. We can definitely do it at finer and finer scales, but one of the things we need to remember is the amount of data we are handling goes up very, very fast. So the computational infrastructure needed will also be much higher.
Thanks a lot, Dito. This is very important to keep in mind. I can maybe just add a comment here. This is pretty new research, and we need to thank Jennings for being the first, I think, few years ago to embark on this new adventure to really see what was the impact of corporate editors. Clearly, as it always happens in research, many things can be done, including limiting or extending the scale of the analysis. I see in this work still a lot of improvements compared to the very previous analysis of some years ago, like the focus on, for example, how co-editing happens, which is very good. Of course, there are many different and possible directions. This is also why I invited the whole community to actually express their wishes now on what needs or what they would need that it is studied, that it is really, what do we need to understand more about this dimension of OpenStreetMap? And it's very important, as I have been saying a lot this morning, that the OSM community at large tries to influence or at least to ask questions to OSM researchers. The next question, is there a way to account corporate editors who is also local in the country? For example, corporate editor editing in the country they are living in. Sometimes paid editing are criticized for being anti the spirit, against the spirit of volunteerism and or crowdsourcing.
This is a very important question for the community. And I will need to collaborate with Maxwell to do this further, because as I said, we had tried previously to understand how local a editor was, but again, there's no easy way of doing it. But Maxwell is again breaking new ground. So that is important research, and hopefully me and Maxwell can collaborate at some point to give you an answer for that.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Dipto. Indeed, this is very important. And also clearly this question leads to the concerns that are there in the community on how the role of corporate editors is perceived. And maybe if we have some time, I will ask you what is your position on these and whether OpenStreetMap should be kind of re-termed instead of a crowdsourcing project as something else. But let me just go first to the last question, but I still invite everyone to ask additional ones in the chat. So is it any prospect for using OSM notes to detect the interactions between corporate and non-corporate editors?
Of course. So that is one of the things we want to do in the near future. But again, like if we are using OSM notes, we have to rely on natural language processing. And again, that is a slightly harder problem than dealing with networks. So as the entry point of dealing with co-editing patterns or interactions between corporate editors and non-corporate editors, we chose the network approach. But looking into notes or emails is one of the things that is definitely in our agenda. Thank you so much for pointing it out.
Indeed, thanks. We have another question, which is actually a request for a clarification on something you said, Dipto, in the presentation. Can you explain again the concept of an edge relates to two mappers, et cetera, that edit one object?
Oh, sure. So in our network, each node represents an editor or a mapper. And initially, all of the editors are unconnected and isolated in space, right? Only when they edit the same object in OSM do they have an edge formed between them. So that is why each edge is associated with two mappers in our network. I hope that clears the confusion.
I also hope this clarifies the issue, but of course I invite the person who asked those that question, but also everyone else in the post-talk chat room after the talk. Dipto will be available in that room to answer additional questions or to engage in discussions. Let me see if we have additional questions. It doesn't seem to be the case, and we still have 5 minutes, so I still invite attendees to ask questions in the chat. Maybe in the meantime, I can just ask something more general to Dipto, not specifically about this research work, but in general on corporate editors and really the how we should really think at the OpenStreetMap project now. Because, you know, in the research community, we like to create acronyms, or we like to to give name to things. So OpenStreetMap has been termed a volunteer geographic information project, a crowdsourcing project, a citizen generated database. So how much are all these terms still true in your opinion? Of course, it's not important what term we use, but really the substance of the word. But I mean, do you feel at least in the academic side of OpenStreetMap that we need to have some new terms to use?
So when the term VGI was coined, I think back in 2008, right? Even at that time, there was some contention about whether there is any true volunteered project in the world, right? I mean, not everyone can contribute equally. So is it really volunteered? So I am personally not a big fan of the term volunteer geographic information because it's too loaded and it does not account for a lot of the dynamics which happens at a global scale. So I still consider OpenStreetMap to be the most successful example of a crowdsourced geographic information system. Anyone can still potentially contribute to it. And no matter who does it, there's no central sense of control. So it is really a crowd product. It's a product of co-editing. It's a product which we all come together to make. It's a product we all come together to validate. And it's a product which all of us can use for free. It is really a crowd good. It is a data infrastructure in which all of us have contributed and all of us can benefit from. So in my opinion, crowdsourced geographic information is the best term to describe OSM. But again, it's an interesting debate to have and I would love to have it.
Yes, indeed, of course. I fully agree with you. I support this because it's basically a crowd. And we very well know that in this crowd, there are really the volunteers, as probably we had at the beginning of OpenStreetMap. But then we also have governments and organizations who release their data for import. We have corporate editors. What is important is, I think, what we can make out of this crowd and how we try to actually work for the benefit of the project. This is the important point, but clearly we have no time for that now, but I'm sure that the role of corporate editors is going to inspire a lot of interesting debate in the future as well. One more question that came in the meantime, again, I think related to somehow related to what we discussed, can you use your findings for data quality measurement?
So again, thank you for this question. It also helps me to clarify some of the work we are doing on this stream. So so data quality is again a very loaded word, right? What do we mean by quality and how do we measure it? So if we are looking at the cathedral and the bazaar type of thing, that the more the number of eyes, the better the quality of a crowdsourced product, then co-editing is definitely a very good measure of data quality in OSM. So it can be used as one of the metrics on which data quality is evaluated. But on the other hand, we are also using some intrinsic quality measures to see how corporate editing impacts data quality in OSM. And again, we are using a very similar approach. We are looking at the same set of places we have presented here. And I can give you the glimpses of it. Like the data analysis is not yet complete, but it seems like the involvement of corporate editors in the platform and in the places where corporate editors are active makes the data quality go up at a faster rate. Again, this is not surprising considering that we are seeing more co-editing patterns in places where there are corporate editing activity. So it's not only because of corporate editors, but it's also because there's something about the dynamics or the interactions the corporate editors are generating in these places, which is making the quality go up at a much, much faster rate compared to places where there is little corporate editing activity. But again, this is very initial results, which I'm sharing with you. And again, this is not very easy to quantify also because data... So data quality does not start from the same baseline everywhere. So it's a hard comparison to do. So we are looking at the rate of improvement, and we are seeing that the rate of improvement is faster.
Thanks a lot, Deepto, and thanks also to Jennings. It was amazing to hear this talk and amazing for me to chair, actually. I would like also to thank the attendees for their input, their questions, and their contributions. Please remind that we will have proceedings of the academic track, so you will also have the chance to read a short paper about this work as well as papers for all the other works. I hope you liked the talk. If yes, please use the button to make an applause. Everyone will be very happy. Deepto will be available in the post-talk chat room to answer additional questions from you. That is it, and I will leave you now and suggest you to join the next talk again from the academic track titled Towards Understanding the Temporal Accuracy of OpenStreetMap, a Quantitative Experiment. Thank you, and see you later.